you off another one. Well, happy Friday, everybody, and welcome to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I hope y'all are having a good day. I really, really do. I hope y'all had a good week. Now, y'all do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love and affection, please, and thank you. And make sure that you have already liked the video on your way in the door. Drop down in the chat box and say, hey, girl, hey, because it's Friday. And what else you got to do besides be happy and say hey to everybody, all right? If you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe to the channel. I promise it's a good time over here, child. Only mess you're going to encounter over here is you're in a kick in the Willy Bobo and we get to talk a shit about these characters in this book, all right? Make sure you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single solitary chapter, all right? So with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my returning sippers and speakers, and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank you for coming back one more again and love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. Listen, I'm ready to get into this thing, because I'm not going to even lie to y'all. Oh my God, I wanted to come back to y'all last night so bad. I really did. Because I'm so goddamn nosy, y'all. I wanted to know what was happening. Okay? Because, oh, man, it got so good. And then I had to go. So it was just like, ugh. But I said, no, I'm not going to go. It was late. Well, it was like around 8 o'clock my time. But I was like, man, I know if I read the next chapter, if I just come out here and give them this next chapter, I'm going to want to read the next one and the next one. And ain't nobody got time for that. It was going to end up being real late. And yeah, no, I wasn't doing that. So let's see who's here so we can get into it, because I know y'all got just as much nose trouble as I do. Hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Happy Friday, sugar. Welcome back to you. I appreciate you being here, darling. And the first sipper and speaker in the door, honey, is Naquetta Faulkner. Happy Friday, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Nordic is second through the door. Got her flask and her handbag, honey, and she is ready. Welcome, darling. Happy Friday. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Yes, child, that one does go crazy. I do like it. I really, really do. Kay is in the building. Hey, girl, hey, happy Friday. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. And then Marva showed up. She came through the door right on time. Happy Friday, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Kim Cash is in the building. Happy Friday, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. So listen, y'all, let my nosy ass get started because, All right, so previously on Butterfly 2, child, listen. Meek and Morgan had decided that they would take 7 days apart from each other, child. And during that time, she promised him. Now she got her drinks and her blacks. Listen, okay? Whatever it takes to get you through this, okay? All right. Morgan said, I'll get rid of Bash because, like, I want to be with you, Meeky. I want to be with you, only you. I'm yours, Daddy. I'm yours, all right? So, child, Meek was working his fingers to the bone trying to get Hack's money because, listen, Hack said, have my shit. Run me my Skrilla. Bitch better have my money. So, yeah. Meek and Issa been working double time, child, trying to get that money. And now we're about to find out how shit shakes out. Because, yeah. All right. So, here we go. Oh, my goodness. All right. Y'all ready? Chapter 16. 1 week later. You look beautiful, Mo. Bash complimented as he sat on the edge of her bed, leaned over to slip his size 13 feet into expensive Tom Ford shoes. Where are we going anyway? Morgan asked. I told you, I don't really feel that well. I could have just stayed in this year. No, there's no staying in. 21 is a big one, Mo. I want to celebrate with my girl. Is that too much to ask? He lifted and swaggered over to her. Now, first of all, I can't even imagine Bash's bitch ass swaggering shit. Weak motherfucker, sorry. He was especially handsome in the gray tailored suit. He shined like money, beard full, cut freshly tapered, penetrating stare. He was really so handsome and so kind, but Morgan could barely stomach Bash. Child, you ain't by yourself. I don't like his ass either. It was Christiana's pushiness, her forcefulness that made Morgan's disdain for her fiancé grow. She felt like she was being held captive by the Fredericks family. It wasn't Bash who she disliked. It was the world he was attached to, the pomp and circumstance of London society, the rules, the overbearing mother-in-law. It was all too much for Morgan. Bash had been consistent. The slip-up in Vegas, him leaving her twins, had exposed a side of him she hadn't known existed, however. It showed he wasn't all the way invested in her children the way he claimed, and Morgan hadn't been in the mood for him since. I don't blame you. Nigga leave my kids, child. His family is going to be attending a funeralization. Think I'm lying. Can you please just cooperate today? Bash asked. I promise by the end of the night you'll be happy. I doubt it, Morgan mumbled. Morgan was becoming horrible at hiding her melancholy. If she was going to celebrate, she wanted to do so with a Meek. She wanted to smile and laugh with him, blow out birthday candles that rested atop a cake that he got for her, make love all night and sleep it off in the morning. Bash was nowhere in her mental plans. Her phone buzzed and Morgan reached inside her crossbody handbag, removing it. It was a text from Meeky, y'all. And he said, "I'm outside." Morgan's heart dipped in anxiety. He hadn't told her he was coming, but it was her birthday, so of course he would come. He was the type of man who would be ready to shower his lady with affection. "I need to run to the car real quick," she said. "We're headed out, Mo. You can just grab whatever it is on the way out," Bash answered. "No, I need to finish my makeup, and what I need is in the car. I'll be another half hour before I'm ready to go anyway. Just keep an eye on the twins. I can go grab it. I'll grab it for you," Bash said, standing. "No," she shouted, louder than she meant to. "My car is filthy. You won't even be able to find it. Relax, I've got it." Child, listen. When that side piece show up on deck, and the side piece is really the piece you want to be your main piece, you be like, "No, don't worry about it. I got it." All right. Morgan walked out of her apartment. The sundress she wore flowed effortlessly, too excited, playing an illusion with her hips as she approached Ahmeek's car. Morgan wanted to run to him, but instead she kept her cool. He got out of the car just to open her door and then pulled off without a care in the world. "What are you doing here?" she asked, smiling. "I thought you said you had business to take care of today. It's your birthday. I can't pull up?" he asked. There was something different in his tone. Intolerance, a bit of frustration. Shit, we all frustrated, hell. "I just didn't know you were coming. I can't stay." "He planned something," Morgan whispered. "Yo, when we giving this nigga his walking papers, love?" Ahmeek asked. Morgan heard the impatience in his tone. She felt it in her gut. Meek was tired of sharing her, tired of filling half her world with happiness, only to send her home to someone else. "It's not that simple," Morgan whispered. "It ain't that hard either," Meek answered. "I know you know that I will take care of you, Mo. Hell, you can take care of yourself, so I'm not understanding the issue. The nigga is either walking away or he can get carried away. I'm sure he got a good 6 men somewhere, pallbearers." Ahmeek was in the mood to send Bash away permanently. Morgan was in the mood to let him. "Ahmeek," she reached for his face and he maneuvered out of her grasp. "Nah, love, no finesse. You get away with the shit I let you get away with. I don't want to be pacified. I want you to go in there and tell that nigga to get fucking lost," Ahmeek said, "so I can put my head between them pretty ass thighs and give you birthday licks. 21. A nigga owes you 21 licks. I'm ready to lock you down, love. Don't stop. Don't pass go." "Meeky," she whispered. "Just give me some time. I promise I will." "Just not today," he scoffed and nodded his head as he turned the wheel, driving in one big rectangle, spinning the block just to sneak and have this conversation with her. Meek didn't sneak anywhere, and the fact that he had to jump through these hoops just to keep time with Mo was beginning to wear on him. He pulled back up to her apartment and put the car in park. He leaned over and reached into the glove box and handed her a box. Morgan opened it. A set of keys lay inside. She lifted her eyes to Ahmeek. "To the loft," he stated. "It'll be empty until you fill it." "You want me to move in with you?" she asked, shocked. He didn't answer. He just looked out his window, forehead wrinkled in irritation as he played with the hair on his chin. "Can I call you later?" she asked. "I just need some time, Ahmeek. I promise I'll call you." He reached into the center console and removed another box. Morgan opened it, and a Jeep key rested inside. "It's in the back of the parking lot. Black Jeep, black tent. Like the one I wanted when I was a little girl," she gasped in shock. "The one you said you got jealous of when your daddy wouldn't buy you a real one to match the ones your Barbie dolls had," Ahmeek stated. "I hope you like it." "I love it," she whispered. Guilt filled her. If she could spend all day with him, just the two of them, it would be a perfect celebration. It was the only gift she wanted. "I'm up, Mo," he said as he put his car in reverse. He was angry at her, and Morgan's eyes filled with tears. "Don't call me Mo. Call me what you normally call me," she whispered. Her lip trembled, his jaw clenched as he grit his teeth and flicked his nose. "Your nigga waiting on you, Mo," he answered. "Meeky," she pleaded, whispering. "I can't get out until you tell me we're okay." "We're good, Mo," he said. "No, we're not. Call me love, Ahmeek. It's my birthday, and you're calling me Mo. You never call me Mo. I don't want to be Mo to you," she cried. Her eyes burned so badly, and her heart was racing. "And I don't want to be your sad nigga," Meek stated, much calmer than she could be in this moment. "Meeky, you're not," she protested. "I don't think of us like that. Stop saying that." Meek popped his locks. "I speak facts. Have fun with your man," he said, still refusing to look at her. Morgan's lip quivered and she opened the door. As she slid out, he caught her fingertips and pulled her back. He fisted her hair and then his lips covered hers. A full 60 seconds turned her to putty. Everything about Ahmeek made Morgan's body react. Her nipples tightened. She could feel the seat of her panties dampen. And her mind erupted. This orgasm he gave her, this mental stimulation, the exploding of her heart and such. Morgan whimpered, she was so affected. "Happy birthday, love," he said, before letting her go. Morgan climbed out of the car and stood there, heartbroken, as she watched him pull away. "Child, listen, it's a little break in the chapter. I am fucking upset." Hey, Shanae, happy Friday. Welcome. Hey, KTG. Welcome, darling. Thank you both for being here. I appreciate you. Uh-oh, Choco Chip is in the building. Happy Friday, Choco Chip. Thank you for sliding into the speakeasy and blessing us with the good vibes, darling. I appreciate you. Right. How much time does she fucking need? Like, go in there and counsel that nigga. I don't understand it. All right. "I don't really want to leave my babies today," Morgan said as Bash pulled up to Ethics Estate. "I want them with me on my birthday." She was trying to keep things light. A family outing was better than a romantic date. She had no idea what Bash had planned for her, but she knew that she didn't want it to feel anything close to a date. "Relax, Mo. Just let me do my thing, okay?" Morgan sighed. "Bash, we need to talk," she said. She could hardly find her words. Mo knew Chris would make good on her threats to ruin everything she had worked for, but Morgan didn't care. She couldn't care anymore. Ahmeek was worth the sacrifice. She would lose everything to gain him. The idea terrified her, but losing him scared her more. "We could talk later, Mo. Let's have some fun today. Celebrate you. It's all about you," he said. He was too excited. Sweet. And Morgan was moody. She wished he was more of an asshole. Breaking things off would be easier if he were. They had their moments, their conflicts, like any normal couple, but Bash was an accommodator. Inconsistencies between them didn't last long. Conflict was easily resolved. Even after his major fuck-up in Las Vegas, he had rebounded strong, spoiling her and apologizing until all was back to normal. But Morgan craved something else. She had a new normal that didn't include him. The enthusiasm that lived in his eyes told her that now was not the time to blow things up. "It's the perfect time, bitch. The fuck? Tonight, I'll tell him. Tonight." Morgan climbed from the car and grabbed Yara from the back seat as Bash took Masari. Morgan didn't even knock. No need to. Ethics' home was her home. It would always be a place she ran to when she needed refuge from the world. Surprise! Morgan's foot hadn't even crossed the threshold fully before she heard the chaos. "Oh my God, you did this?" Morgan asked, beaming from ear to ear as she turned to Bash, coyly hiding her face as a titter bounced off her lips. "Happy birthday," Easy screamed, wrapping his hands around her waist. "Thank you, Easy. Happy birthday, Mo Money." Bella was next. Morgan hugged her. "Hey, Mo, happy birthday, baby girl," Alani greeted. Ethic was last, and Morgan walked up to him, cheesing. "I can't believe you're 21. I still see a snaggletooth little girl when I look at you, Mo," Ethic said as he pulled her into his arms. He kissed her cheek, burying his face against the side of her head before kissing her cheek again, once, then twice. "Happy birthday, baby girl. I want you to enjoy your party. You deserve it. You deserve all the happiness in the world, Mo. Before you leave, after things wind down, I want to talk to you." "Is everything okay?" she asked, pulling back. "Everything will be fine, but it's important," Ethic said. "Should we talk now?" she asked. "No, you should enjoy your party," he stated. She nodded as Ethic kissed Yara's cheek and took Masari from Bash before crossing the room, leading Alani to a chair. "There's a DJ outside, Mo," Bella said as she led the way. "Okay, lead the way," Morgan said. She carried Yara to the back. Bash followed behind her. A DJ spun on the deck, and as soon as Mo walked through the sliding door, she noticed that no expense had been spared. The backyard was set up extravagantly, rose gold and gold accents everywhere. Expensive linen and an acrylic wall with her name on it had been built in the backyard. Professional linens and tables were set up. A tile dance floor had been set up in the middle of the massive lawn. Her favorite flowers were everywhere. "This is amazing," she smiled and turned to Bash, feeling so bad about the way she felt about him. "You're a really good guy, Bash. You're such a great friend to me, and I hope you know that." "Bitch!" Aria's voice carried through the air, and Morgan's eyes found her instantly. Beyonce dropped through the speakers. "You a bad girl, and your friend's bad, too. We got the swag sauce. She dripping swagoo." Aria owned any dance floor she ever graced, and to Mo's surprise, Issa was out there with her. Issa swaggered casually behind her, pinching a blunt between two fingers with one hand and holding up a styrofoam cup in the other as his lanky frame caught the beat in a lazy two-step as Aria showed out in front of him. We like to party. Morgan made her way to the dance floor, and with Yara in her arms, she bounced playfully. Happy birthday, Mo, Aria laughed, pausing long enough to kiss Mo's cheek and then Yara's. Issa passed his cup to Aria and took Yara from Mo's arms. Yara laughed as Issa did a cool bop with her as his dance partner. She beat on his face, hands slapping his cheeks as he took her for a spin. A blunt and a baby were his accessories. It was an old school ghetto kickback in the middle of the opulence Epic provided. Mo was in heaven. There was only one person missing. She turned and met eyes with Bash, who sat in one of the chairs beneath the huge event tent. Be careful, sis. Don't get that nigga hurt, Issa called after her as she made her way to Bash. Boy, Aria fussed. I'm just saying. My nigga ain't here, so I'm gonna hold him down. It's fuck nigga Friday in this bitch, Issa said as he hit the blunt. He turned his head and blew the smoke in the opposite direction of Yara. Say fuck nigga Friday, Yollipop. How you sign that shit? Give me my niece, Aria shouted, and stop starting shit with that man. Don't you always tell me to mind my business? And your hard-headed ass never do it either. Now, I know the fuck why, Issa snickered. Yo, bruh, have some respect. It's kids here. My kids are here. Watch your mouth, Bash stated. He stood as Morgan made it to his side. Issa stopped dancing. Morgan knew it was a problem when his hand went to his hip. Nigga, what? Issa was across the dance floor in seconds, but Morgan and Aria stood in his way. I ain't afraid of you, man. It's whatever you want to do, Bash said, rolling up his sleeves. I want to murder you, nigga, Issa said. Aria was in front of him, pushing his chest as Mo pushed Bash in the opposite direction. How about that? I ain't just talking, nigga. I'll put you where the worms be, pussy. Aria passed Yara to Morgan so she could use all her strength to stop Issa. Tired of dodging Aria, Issa put his hands under her armpits and picked her up, carrying her toward Bash. Bella, go get Ethic now, Morgan yelled. Easy took off running toward the house first. I'm right here, man. I'm not running, Bash shouted back. Bash, my babies are out here, Morgan screamed. Ethic was halfway across the lawn when Morgan heard the voice carry through the speakers. Issa, you wild as fuck, G. Let that nigga breathe, man. Morgan froze. Her blood solidified in her veins as she lost feeling in her hands as she felt Yara slipping from her grasp. Her legs ached like she was too heavy, like she could no longer support her own weight. Everything went still. Even the breeze that had given her a slight chill ceased to exist. Hey, shorty doo-wop. Messiah stood before her, living, breathing. She blinked once, then twice. He wasn't real. He couldn't be real. She heard his voice in her head, sometimes saying those exact words because she had been his shorty doo-wop, and she never wanted to forget what he sounded like, but she had never seen him before, not while she was awake, never outside her dreams. Morgan felt like she was in a daze as she turned her head to Ethic. She saw pain in his stare, confirmation that what she was seeing wasn't a figment of her imagination. Ethic made his way to her side. She couldn't find her voice as she turned her head back to Messiah. He stood, dark denim, black sweatshirt, wheat Timberlands, and a low-cut Caesar. His locks were gone, his image blurred, tears. They were blinding her. My leash. Why would he break my leash? His hair had been her favorite part of him, and him cutting them felt like a personal insult. It was gone, but he was here. How? Morgan couldn't even hear. It was like she had gone deaf all over again. Everything was tuned out, or was everyone as speechless as she was? Come here. Let me see you, shorty, Messiah signed. It was like he had shot a gun that started a race. Morgan's body reacted. She passed Yara to Ethic before he could utter one word. She barely made sure her child was in his arms before she ran to Messiah. She plowed into him, and Messiah fisted her hair, pulling her into his body so tightly that they became one. Her heart raced against his chest. Messiah swore he felt it beating, pulsing, her heart making his heart stronger, her pulse, her energy keeping him alive. She always had been life for him, always had been his reason for living. Her feet no longer touched the floor as he hugged her. Morgan sobbed. She bawled. Everyone present was silenced at the intensity of the love before them. Everyone stared, but no one moved except Messiah. He took weighted steps, carrying her into the house, bypassing Alani and the kids and up the stairs because he didn't want to share this moment. He couldn't because he was going to lose it. His levees were about to break. He could feel the burning in his eyes, and no one could see that but her. He entered Bella's bedroom. Shh, he soothed. Morgan trembled so viciously in his hold that even her teeth chattered. I'm right here. Shh, shorty, stop crying. She wanted to, but she couldn't. Her body was in an uproar. Her heart was going haywire. Her lungs wouldn't suck in enough air. Her eyes wouldn't stop leaking. She was dying right there in his arms. Messiah had returned to her, and she was about to leave him. She was about to die. He would have to say goodbye because Morgan couldn't live through this. It was too much. He placed hands, real hands, tangible fingertips to the sides of her face as he pulled her off his shoulder. "Let me see my girl," he whispered. He cleared the snot from her top lip with a swipe of his thumb. "Pretty ass," he admired. Morgan's hands were leaves on the limbs of a tree. They shook so hard she thought they would fall off as she placed both hands to his face, her holding him holding her. No sound but her tears as they stared at one another. "How are you here?" she finally said, scraping up the remnants of her voice. "Messiah, how?" "I told you, I'ma always come back to you, Mo. I'm never leaving you, Shorty." Morgan's chest felt weighted as it dipped in turmoil. "Where have you been, Messiah?" Messiah's eyes closed involuntarily, his name on her lips, those Z's. He had waited a long time to hear her say it. It disturbed him at his core, ripping up all his reserve, and he bit down on his bottom lip to stop himself from breaking down. Damn, if Morgan was the only person on earth capable of making a bitch of him. His heart was pounding in anxiety just at the sight of her. "I've been trying to get back, Shorty. I've been..." Morgan pushed him. "Where have you been?" she shouted, her face folded in excruciation. This was real. This was a dagger, another dagger through her heart. The realization that he had been living and breathing somewhere without her, that he had stayed away for 2 fucking years without her, it destroyed her. "Do you know what I've been through?" she asked. Memories of her inside that car all those years ago flashed through her mind, playing the mini movie of her life since he'd gone away. Her shock had worn off and was replaced with inexplicable rage. It pulsed through her as she remembered the last time she'd seen him. He had humiliated her. He had told her he didn't care, that she hadn't meant anything to him. He had reached inside her chest, fisted her heart, and ripped it away from every single strand of flesh that kept it lodged inside her body. She had been hollowed out ever since, like a carcass. She was empty. "I'm so sorry, Shorty." Morgan pushed him. He barely budged. "You murdered me," she screamed. She pushed him again, jerking him, but not moving him. "I'm sorry," Messiah said, lifting hands of surrender. "You're disgusting. I hate you. I fucking hate you. It's been 2 years, 2. Morgan pushed him again and again. Then she slapped him. Her hand landed across his cheek so viciously that the impact turned his head. Morgan's fingers curled into a fist and she swung. "You just left me here. You just left. You destroyed me." Messiah arrested her hands and Morgan sobbed against him. "How could you?" she cried, melting. His sudden emergence in her life leveled her. Morgan's cries was so loud that a crowd gathered outside the door. When it opened, she was on her hands and knees sobbing as the emotional storm wrecked her. "Shorty, don't do this to me. Baby, please. Mo, just let me explain." "I can explain," he said. Morgan smelled Ethic before she saw him. "Ethic, help me. Please help me," she sobbed. "Morgan," Messiah's voice was injured, pleading. Damn, he hadn't meant for her to feel any of this. Ethic picked Mo up from the ground, scooping her into his arms. He didn't even acknowledge Messiah as she wrapped arms around his neck and hid her face in his chest. "Mo, baby, Messiah," Alani's voice corralled him. He walked toward her, lip trembling, and without ever knowing where his feet were leading him, he fell into Alani's arms. Messiah held onto Alani like she was his mama, like she would heal his aching soul, like if she told him it would be okay, it magically would be just that. Okay. Messiah was a motherless boy and a womanless man, and the way Morgan had reacted to him had obliterated him. The shit hurt so fucking bad that it almost numbed it. Sorry. So much pain that he could barely feel it. Morgan, the man's voice calling Mo's name caused Messiah to pull away from Alani. "Messiah, no," Alani called after him, but he was already out of her grasp. When he stepped into the hallway, the sight of Morgan in someone else's arms, not Ethics, but Bash, it was like a bullet. Cancer couldn't kill him, but this could. It would. Damn, why was his heart bleeding? He could feel it, the squeeze inside his chest. Bash met his stare, and Messiah took steps toward him until he saw the two children that Morgan was reaching for. She grabbed a baby girl from Bella and a boy from Easy, and Messiah stumbled backward like someone had delivered a blow that knocked him off balance. He had seen them before. He knew she'd had them. The Instagram posts had shown him she was a mother now, but to see it up close, to see those innocent eyes, those pretty faces that matched her face almost exactly, and to see Bash, their father, it was a fillet knife to Messiah's soul. Karma was sliding that bitch back and forth, cutting away hope. Any chance he thought he had at getting her back felt minuscule. I need to leave, Mo said. Messiah turned and placed bald fists on top of his head. She was leaving and dragging his heart behind her like the soda cans he used to hook to string on the back of his bike. He wanted to stop her. He wanted to fucking kill the corny nigga beside her, but the destruction he had caused was too great and there were so many eyes watching. He didn't want to make a bigger scene than they already had. He had made a spectacle of her before. Doing that again would cripple her. Perhaps the first time had already done that. Her eyes looked different. Staring into them felt different. Morgan's light had been extinguished. He had done that. He had seen it turn off 2 years ago when he left her. The moment he had shouted, I don't give a fuck anymore. He had noticed the change in her. It was like he had hit a switch, cloaking her in darkness. She had gotten used to the gloom, and now that he was trying to pull her out, now that he wanted to live in the light with her, she was forever changed, forever cloaked in gloom. Fuck. That's the end of that chapter. This nigga, man. Who the fuck told him to come? Ethic specifically told his black ass to wait until I give you the green light. Get your business together. Stack your paper, nigga. I'm gonna help you, nigga. Here's a sledgehammer and a check, nigga. Get this funeral home up and running and then open another and another and a sister and a brother. Do that, and then I'll tell you when you can approach her. But no. Emotional ass, fucking irresponsible ass, fucking overly spontaneous ass Messiah had to go and wreck the buffet at her 21st birthday party. You already ruined her pregnancy, my nigga. She couldn't even be gloriously, beautifully, wonderfully, enjoyably pregnant. You wrecked that shit. Right? Then you wreck her state of new motherhood. She stuck with Bash of all the motherfuckers she could possibly end up with his stick up the ass ass mama. And now you ruin her 21st birthday? Why the fuck are you here, sir? God damn. Man. It's bullshit, yo. I cannot with this nigga. Man, Ethic should have just put a bullet in his ass right there and then just shot everybody else at the party that might be a fucking snitch. Yeah. I'm just like, I wanted Messiah to beat Bash ass, though, or for Issa to slump his ass. That would have been cool with me. Just slump the fuck out of him. I'm like, oh, my God. I don't know if she should tell him them kids is his because this nigga, man, I don't even understand. You said, just call me QQ. Oh, child, listen, I hope I can remember that. Okay, so Shanae said he had to calm down the situation between Bash and he said he didn't have to do shit. Ethic was on his way to handle that. Messiah didn't have to say shit, Shanae. He really didn't. This ain't his party. Yo, ass, I don't even know why the fuck Messiah was there. Like, I don't understand. Mm-mm. Like, this is fucking, I don't even understand it. Anyway, let me just get my time stamp for the next chapter. Because just like an old rancid ass nigga, he got to fucking show up and just fuck up shit. Punk ass Chauncey. Yeah, I was about to go left, but damn, he ain't had to say shit. Chapter 17. Messiah sat on the floor in Bella's room. He hadn't moved, couldn't move. The sting that caused his eyes to prickle was moving through his entire body. Morgan's disdain was electrocuting him. His knees were bent, arms wrapped around them, one hand clasping the opposite wrist. His head was bowed. Regret pushed it down. Like a dog being punished, his face was pushed into his mistake. Messiah's blood boiled as he pictured Morgan walking down the steps with her kids and her man. Only he wasn't her man. He could never be her man because the position wasn't vacant. It would never be vacant because Messiah was never quitting on the job. The image tore through his mind like a tornado, causing his chest to fill with a cloud of hurt so potent that it felt like he couldn't breathe. He clenched his teeth as he rocked back and forth. Messiah? The voice was so damn soft, Messiah felt like there was an angel sitting on his shoulder. I'm good, he said, his voice gritty. Okay, she said. Messiah saw Lonnie lower to his view as she sat on the floor in front of him. Her round belly was so big that it sat in her lap as she tried to sit Indian style. So you will definitely have to help me get up from here, she said, out of breath and smiling. Messiah scoffed and shook his head, but didn't speak. He didn't know Alani well, didn't know her at all, in fact. All he knew was that Ethic loved her and that she had forgiven him after he'd killed her daughter. She had forgiven a tragic mistake, pardoned the unfathomable. And as she sat before him, she almost glowed. Alani, Ethic's voice came from behind Messiah. It was territorial, protective, stern. Ezra, her voice was sterner, more protective. It was so matter of fact that Messiah had to look up because he couldn't ever remember anyone taking that tone with Ethic before. We're fine, she said. He looked up at Ethic, who deadpanned on him. It was a silent conversation between them. Walk real fucking light with my wife. Messiah heard the message without the utterance of words before Ethic left the room. Is she happy with that nigga? Messiah asked. Not with him, Alani answered. No. Why did you come today, Messiah? If Ethic asked you to wait until after her birthday, why did you come anyway? Alani asked. I just wanted to see her. I've been back too long and I ain't seen my shorty, Messiah stated. So you ruined her birthday? Alani asked, frowning in confusion. You put your needs before hers and decide when and how she should receive the news that you're alive, and you choose a house full of spectators to witness the reunion? You had to know seeing you would unravel her, and you wanted people to see her like that? Her words hit Messiah, arrow to the heart. I didn't think about that, he said. That's your problem, Messiah. You think of you first and her second. You have to always think about her, how she's gonna feel if what you want supports what she needs. Morgan is a sensitive girl. She's a woman. We need to be handled delicately. How did you forgive him? Messiah asked. His chin quivered and he put his head down. When you found out what Ethic had done, you loved him anyway. I need her to love me like that through everything, you know? So how did you do it? Alani paused, closing her eyes as she sucked in a deep breath. He took her in. She really was beautiful. Even with the roundness from her pregnancy filling her face, Alani radiated. She wore the confidence of a woman who was sure of the decisions she had made in life. She was cloaked in peace, like she had come to terms with the turmoil that had led her to this home, with this man, in this role. It had taken her a while to grow into this woman, to wear this heavy crown, but she did it gracefully, like she had been on this throne her entire life. When she opened her eyes, they glistened with emotion. He was my heir, Messiah. I didn't have a choice but to forgive him. If I wanted to live, I had to breathe, and he was heir, Alani whispered. You abandoned her when she needed you most. She's been through a lot. I've been through a lot, Messiah blurted. I was sick when I left, and I fucked Shorty over so bad that I couldn't look her in the eyes and ask her to hold my hand while I died. I snaked Shorty. I pulled the rug from under her feet. I couldn't ask her for shit after that. I'm not even supposed to be here, but I'm here, and I want her so damn bad, man. I just want her. I'm sick, and I don't know if I got one day or 100, but they hers if she want them. I just want her to want them. Messiah's chest rocked, and a rare sob surfaced before he swallowed it down, choking on remorse. He trapped his emotions so tightly inside him that the vein in his forehead bulged. Oh, Messiah, Alani said. She reached out and wrapped a soft hand around his forearm. She gave a gentle squeeze, and Messiah recoiled, snatching away from her so viciously that she fell forward a bit. Messiah. His reaction was like she had touched him with fire, an instinct to pull away from touch, from the touch of someone he didn't trust. Alani knew that instinct well. Who hurt you, Messiah? She asked. Emotion filled her eyes as she watched him pull himself from the ground. Somebody hurt you bad, touched you the wrong way, someone who loved you. You don't know shit, he snapped. That's why you're afraid to love people. Why you walk around hurting people who love your ass? Alani climbed to her feet. Stop talking about what you don't know, Messiah said. Don't bend my name. Sexually. Somebody abused you sexually? Alani pressed. Couldn't be a woman. You would find that brag worthy. A hood nigga getting pussy early? You would brag on that. A man hurt you. No! Messiah barked it so loud that Ethic entered the room. Alani's eyes widened. Get out, Ethic, Alani ordered. She didn't even look at him. Her stare was on Messiah's. His burned into her. Eyes glossy, red, tortured. We're fine. This ain't for you. He's not gonna hurt me. I'm a big girl. A little yelling ain't never hurt nobody. I yell at your ass all the time. Alarm, Ezra. The authority in her voice silenced him instantly. His eyes met hers. See, I yelled. Nothing happened. We're fine. Right, Messiah? She challenged Messiah with her stare again. A long silence filled the room as they faced off. He was like a wild animal, cornered, trying to decide if he was going to surrender or fight his way out of this corner. His chest heaved and he relented. Yeah, he answered. Ethics reluctance ate him alive, but he retreated from the room. Alani knew she had pressed Messiah too hard. He didn't know her, didn't trust her. Where are you staying, Messiah? Alani asked. I'm around, he answered. You got food in your refrigerator? She probed. Nah, I got a partner who's a chef, he answered. You don't know how to cook for yourself? She asked. Oh, I'm a sous chef when it comes to that work. A nigger burn his eggs, though, every time, Messiah stated. Alani's eyes softened. You sound like somebody else I know, she whispered. Messiah was grateful that the conversation had eased into the slow lane. When Alani put her foot on the gas pedal, it made tension creep up his spine. I go grocery shopping every Saturday morning. I go early, though, at like 6 o'clock. Can you take me in the morning? Ezra is busy and Easy can't carry all the groceries by himself. You can stay for breakfast afterwards and get some things for your place, too, she said. She was asking him. Messiah heard the question, but it didn't seem like he had a choice to decline. It sounded more like a demand, and he wondered how she'd made him feel obliged to say yes when he really wanted to say no. He didn't even know if he was allowed to say no. The hand propped on her hip and the raised brow that awaited his answer put a tremor in his chest. What the fuck? He thought. It was like she just might reach out and pop his ass if he said the wrong thing. Yeah, I can do that, he agreed. Alani nodded. Good. Messiah's chin tilted a bit and he stared down the bridge of his nose at her. Be her heir? He asked. Alani nodded. Give her life. Don't make her feel like she wants to die, Alani answered. And be patient with her. You can't just show up and expect things to go back to the way they used to be between you two. Morgan is a different girl. She has different needs, and a lot has happened since you left. You have to understand that you can't control how people move on from you. If you want any chance of fixing things, you have to love without judgment. I'll see you tomorrow morning. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Fuck this nigga. I wouldn't give a fuck if he was over there popping cans of Alpo. Mm-mm. No, God. We want him to go. Well, maybe that's just me. But I don't give a fuck. I said it, and I meant it. I want him out of here. No. Right. Me too, Nikweta. I want her with Ahmeek. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's who she needs to be with. I like how she is with him. Listen, Messiah should have took his punk ass on over there to Blue and sat the fuck down and ate his fucking food. That's what the fuck he should have done. Because the way I feel, No, nigga, you don't get to come back and wreck the buffet at the Hero Club. Fuck is you thinking, boy? Mm-mm. Ain't nobody even checking for your ass like that no more, nigga. Mm-mm. Chapter 18. The exhaustion that plagued her penetrated her bones as Morgan pushed through her front door, carrying Yara on her shoulder. You sure you don't want me to stay? Bash asked. She turned to him and placed a finger to her lips. She knew the sound of his baritone would stir Masari. He was a light sleeper and would pop up off Bash's shoulder if they weren't completely silent. She flicked the light switch and kicked out of her boots before traipsing through the apartment to her nursery. She placed Yara down in her crib as Bash put Masari down to rest. Morgan turned the baby monitor on and then crept out of the room. So you really want me to leave? I could stay, Bash said. Morgan shook her head. No, you should go to your place tonight. Are we okay, Morgan? Messiah being back, does that change anything with us? It changes everything. Things have been different. You were never the one. You could never be the one, she thought. She didn't have the heart to let the words fall from her lips. Not tonight. A night where her entire world had been flipped upside down. She just wanted to be alone. She didn't have the strength to fight. She was stunned, lost, confused. So many emotions swirled in her. She didn't know how she felt. Relief, anger, love, hate. It all bombarded her at the same time. She could barely breathe. A knot of apprehension tore through her stomach. Morgan just wanted to sleep, rest, close her eyes, and let the darkness give her momentary solace because she couldn't take this. Reality was merging with her dreams anyway because that's where Messiah lived. How the hell had he walked out of her head and into Ethic's backyard? How had her dreams come true? She could see him, she could hear him, and suddenly she wondered if she could touch him, if she could run her fingers through his locks. No, she couldn't. They were gone. He cut his hair, his locks, my locks. How could he cut them, she thought. Morgan, Bash said, brow dipping in discontent as he waited on her answer. Yeah, we're, who the fuck told him to cut his hair, she thought. We're good, she finally managed. I just need time to think, just tonight. Please, Bash, this is a lot. He nodded and kissed her forehead. Morgan pulled back. Her body went rigid. There was a time when something as simple as a forehead kiss would have been hazardous to Bash's health. That forehead had been reserved for one person until he had lied, until he had died. How? Bash stared at her, lingering for a moment before walking out of the apartment. Pause. That's Bash's fucking problem. He always smothering her with his motherfucking presence. Nigga, stop being overbearing like your mother. Just because a bitch lets you be around don't mean she really wants you there. And it don't make her love you any more than she doesn't already. As soon as she heard the door close, Morgan felt her eyes prickle. She had wanted to fold when she laid eyes on Messiah, but there were so many people watching, waiting for her reaction. He was waiting for her reaction. If she had learned nothing from Christiana over the 2 years, the one thing she had learned was how to retain a poker face. Morgan's insides were in turmoil as she made her way to her kitchen. A bottle of tequila. She had never needed it more. She pulled a bottle from her pantry and didn't even bother with a glass. She grabbed the first thing she saw, a red cup, and filled it to the top. Morgan lifted the red cup to her nude lips, one large gulp, and her jaw slackened as she let the liquor linger on her tongue before lifting her head to the sky and letting it slide down her throat. She looked at the ceiling, shaking her head, back and forth, forth and back. Disbelief. Morgan was in utter disbelief. She took another sip, grabbed the bottle, and melted to the floor. For so long, she had wondered why no funeral had been arranged, why she hadn't been contacted about his body, why Blue hadn't known where he was buried. There had been so many unknowns because his ass was alive all this time. How could he leave me here? I would have gone with him. Wherever he was, I would have gone. I would have run with him just like Raven, just like a moth to a flame. I would have. Morgan's knees met her chest and she finished the cup, then poured another. The burning that accompanied withholding tears was unbearable, and when she could no longer hold them, they fell. Her phone rang and Morgan crawled to the couch, snatching the strap and pulling it to her. She retrieved it and answered the call. Aria, I'm dreaming. Tell me this isn't real, Morgan cried. Open the door, Mo. I'm outside, she said. Morgan sniffed, wiping her runny nose with the back of her hand before pulling herself from the floor. She didn't even know where she found the strength in her legs to make it to the door, but with a dizzy head, she pulled it open. Aria leaned her head against the doorframe. I brought liquor and Twizzlers, Aria said with a sympathetic smile as she held up a brown paper bag. Morgan scoffed through the emotion that overwhelmed her and stepped aside so Aria could enter. He's back, Morgan whispered, tilting her head back to look at the ceiling. Her tears ran, pooling in her ears. He is, Aria said. Leave it up to Messiah. Aria shook her head. It has to be a relief, Mo. He's alive. That's a good thing, right? It's the best thing, Morgan whispered, sobs racking her as she lowered her head. She rushed toward Aria, crying so hard that she couldn't breathe. How could he leave me here? It's been so long. Morgan pulled back, closing her eyes and shaking her head. I'm fucking Ahmeek. You're doing more than that, Mo, Aria said. I told him I would leave Bash after my birthday. I was supposed to move in with him, Aria. He's waiting for me. He gave me a key to his loft. He gave me the loft and a car, and now Messiah's back. Oh my God, he's back. I don't even know what to feel. This is a lot for anybody, Mo. I just want you to take your time with it. Process it. The last thing anyone wants for you is to get overwhelmed. Messiah has a habit of making you feel worthless, making you feel like you can't keep breathing. I can breathe just fine without him, Aria. He taught me that I could live without him. That's what scares me most, Morgan admitted. He left, and I died a little on the inside. Walked around not even noticing anything. Nothing was funny. Nothing was beautiful. Everything just irritated me. Even the sounds of my baby sometimes made me cringe. I almost wanted to be deaf again. I've never said that to anyone. What type of mother thinks that? One who was left devastated. One who lost her peace when their father died, Aria said. Meek, makes me feel like I'm the best person he's ever known. He makes me feel like I'm doing a good job with the twins. He loves to watch me dance. He's always amazed by it, not even just at the shows, but when I'm here and putting some bullshit 8 count together in the mirror, he just watches. And him and Yara, Mo whispered that last part and closed her eyes. I could have spent the rest of my life watching him with her. Now I have to give him up. You don't have to do anything, Mo. You don't owe Messiah any explanations, but he owes you a long one. You gotta talk to him, and you have to tell him about his kids, Aria said. That's a card you've been holding, and you should have played it. I can't, Morgan said, shaking her head. I don't even know him. Like, who is he? He lied to my face, plotted on my family. I have no idea who he is. I'm so fucking mad at him, Aria, I could kill him. I can't turn my kids over to a man I don't know. Morgan, if you do this, everything changes. You can't cry victim and do something like this. If you don't tell him, you become wrong. You haven't been so far. You aren't wrong for anything else you've done. But this, if you keep that man's kids from him, that's dead ass wrong, Mo. And if he finds out and murders every fucking body over his kids, he'll be justified. I just have to be sure about him first. He was going to kill Ethic, she snapped. She had never told Aria that. She had never wanted to look foolish enough and admit that she had fallen in love with a man who would do something so cruel. She hadn't wanted to make it seem like she had been a mark, a way in, a ploy for Messiah to get to Ethic. Morgan, you're playing with me, right? I wish I was, Morgan answered. Morgan had never shared the depths of Messiah's betrayal with Aria. It was so much more complex than just heartbreak. Familial warfare was a part of their history. He's dangerous, Aria. I'm not trusting him with my kids until I'm 100% sure he's here for the right reasons. Morgan's gut churned. Turmoil bubbled in her like lava, all-consuming, reintroducing her to an aching that paralyzed her. How is he here? She kept asking the same question over and over again. It felt like she was dreaming because she had dreamt this dream before. Aria went to the linen closet and retrieved a blanket and a pillow. I don't know, Mo. The part of me that knows Messiah doesn't think he would ever do anything to hurt you. I can't even see him wanting to hurt your fine-ass daddy. Morgan released a small laugh, letting some of the woe on her heart go. But damn, it was so heavy. Messiah's return was almost harder than his disappearance. She knew how to mourn him. She knew how to let go of the past because she hadn't wanted to hate him from the grave. But to see him again was crippling. It meant he had chosen to abandon her. It made all her resentment rush back like a flood. She could hardly keep her emotional bearings. I'll take the couch, Aria said, plopping down next to Morgan. I'm okay. I don't need babysitting. I really just want to be by myself. I just want to cry. I want to cry without anyone being here to hear me. He cut his locks, Aria. Why would he cut his hair? I loved his hair, she whispered, eyes filling to the brim and then spilling. Crystal tears ran down her cheeks. I used to love him. Do you still? Aria asked. Morgan's face crushed, painting a story of hurt. He took my soul away when he left. He broke my heart, and the first thing I felt when I heard his voice was a pulse. I felt him in my veins, Aria. I just wanted to touch him to see if he was real. A knock at the door made Morgan's heart tense in anticipation. Aria lifted, leaving Mo on the couch, doubled over in complete agony. Morgan, it's Ahmeek, Aria said, unsurely. I'm gonna go. I know you're okay with him here. Aria looked at Meek. Call me if she needs anything. Ahmeek didn't look at Aria. His eyes were fixed on Morgan. He nodded, though. He heard her. He knew the stakes. Mo's emotions were out of control, and she was dangerous to herself when that happened. As soon as Issa called his line with the unbelievable news, his stomach hollowed. Gratefulness and uncertainty filled the space where his future once lived because he had no idea what this meant for him and Mo. Aria walked out the door. Morgan turned, holding onto the back of the couch with one hand. They were silent, staring at one another like they were soaking each other in, noting every detail because they weren't sure if they would get the opportunity to again. Ahmeek stood in front of her, brow furrowed in worry, eyes shining with confusion. The sight of him both stirred and disturbed her soul. Ahmeek, Messiah's left hand, and her lover. What a fucking complicated mess she had made. Her lip quivered. Is it true? He's alive? Meek asked. There was something in his tone, a break, hope wrapped in disbelief with a bow of sadness on top because Messiah's return changed so many things. Morgan couldn't even find her voice. She just nodded. She rushed into his arms, sobbing. How had they gotten to this place? He's back, she cried. God, Meek, what have I done? He held her tightly and grit his teeth. palming the back of her head, pressing her into his body. They were tormented. "What have we done, Mo? Not just you. What have we done?" he said. "I'm dying." Meek gripped the sides of her face and placed a kiss on her forehead. "Mo, I know what this means. He's back and we can't. We shouldn't have in the first place." Morgan wilted in his arms. "I'm so sorry." "Shh." She needed his consoling. She needed it so badly. "Stop, love. I can't, Meek," she sobbed. She was sucking in air, hyperventilating, panicking. "Meek, I can't breathe." "You can," he stated, "because you're the fucking catch, Mo. You can dismiss niggas and keep sitting pretty. I'm not what makes you dope, love. Neither is he. I need you to remember that. Shit about to get rough, love. Real rough, confusing, chaotic. It'll probably hurt a little bit, maybe a lot, but you're in control, Mo. The queen is always in control, so you can do anything, Morgan. No matter what happens or who's in your life, you gon' always come out on top." Morgan pushed out air, grasping his forearms as she lifted pain eyes to his. She sucked in a deep breath. "I love you," she whispered. 2 hours ago, I could see my whole life with you. I'm in love with you, Ahmeek." "I know, love," he answered. "You don't have to prove that. I know what it is with us. I know what it is with you and him, too. I can't even be mad at it because a nigga is breathing, Mo. A nigga I thought I lost is breathing." Ahmeek flicked his nose and sniffed back emotion as his eyes glistened. He kissed the top of her head. "He's my brother, Mo. I thought he was dead." Meek released her and turned from her, lifting both hands to his head. She heard him lock his emotions away. The sniff of his nose was the only thing that gave him away. Morgan touched him and he shook his head. "I gotta go check on him. I wanted to come here first. I wanted to see you, Mo." He turned and blew out a sharp breath. She reached up for him, soft hands wrapping around his neck as he pressed his forehead to hers. She sighed. This felt so good. Bliss. It was all she ever felt with Ahmeek. There was no flux of emotions, no fighting, no battling, just loving. That's all they ever did was love. He didn't waste time fighting or confusing or disappointing or deceiving. Love was just a word with Messiah. He said one thing and then did another. It was a verb with Ahmeek. He put it into action every single day. Even in this moment when everything they wished they could have was in jeopardy, the way he looked at her was full of love. "I love you. I love you. I love you so much. I love you, Meeky. I love this. I love us," she whispered. "Mo," he interrupted. "No, just let me say it, Ahmeek. Let me tell you. Let me say it a million times just in case something changes. Just in case." She stopped talking. "He's back, Ahmeek. I don't know if I'll ever get to say this to you again, so just let me say it now. We are real. This with you is real, and I'm in love with you. I felt magical on that dance floor with you in London while Stevie Wonder played in the background. I felt that same feeling every day since. I left London because I wanted to be near you. I wanted to use Friday night card games as an excuse to see you." "You came home for me?" he asked, disbelieving. "I was gone for years, Ahmeek. You gave me a few hours in London, and I wanted more. I wanted you. It's crazy, I know, but I bought a ticket home before you ever stepped foot on the plane to leave. I came home for you," she confirmed. "I want to kiss you, love, but in the back of my mind, I'm seeing my nigga. He's back, and that shit is fucking me up," he admitted. "I gotta go talk to bro, man. I gotta figure this shit out. You okay? Here by yourself?" "No, but because of you, I will be. The queen doesn't fold. I'm your queen, right?" she asked. "Every day of every week, love," he answered. He kissed her forehead and Morgan placed her fingertips on the side of his face. They lingered there and then Ahmeek pulled back, opening the door. Morgan felt her body revolt when it closed behind him. She gripped her shirt as a nagging filled her chest. Morgan felt like she was drowning. Her past was colliding with her future, taking away her chance to be with this man, and it was unbearable. It was like she had to decide who to love all in an instant, Meek or Messiah. Did she even want to traipse back down the road that led to Messiah? It was bumpy, rough. Meek was smooth. Meek was effortless, and she was letting him walk away. Morgan snatched open the door. "Ahmeek!" she shouted his name with a desperation he had never heard her possess. He turned from the elevator and she ran to him. His embrace was like a sanctuary and her heart thundered as he picked her up, arms wrapped tight around her back, lips on hers. Her feet never touched the ground as he took wide steps carrying her back to her door. They stood outside her place, submerged in one another, her hands on his face, then around his neck, finessing the nape of him. She sniffed, crying as she inhaled this man. Every single second that she had wasted with him before was now a regret. She kissed him so deeply that he stumbled forward, removing one hand to put it against the wall and then pulling her waist into his body. Morgan was a mess, an emotional hurricane. "What are we going to do?" she asked as she lowered her head into his chest, squeezing her eyes tight. "I can't pretend like this didn't happen. I couldn't choose between you and Messiah, and now he's back. I only have one heart, Meek. Who am I supposed to give it to? Can't give that bitch to nobody because I ain't never give it back. Messiah. Fucking Messiah." His voice made Morgan freeze. Her limbs turned to steel. His baritone made the hair on the back of her neck stand up. She gripped Meek's collar as her forehead hit his chest in disgrace. She turned her head to the side, away from Messiah, as she sobbed, "Meek, please make him leave. I can't." Morgan's heart was on the floor. She couldn't handle this. She couldn't do this right now. Here they were, the three of them. Her transgressions were out in front of them, clear as day. There was no excusing what Messiah had just interrupted. Three people and only two seats at the table. "Just go inside," Meek instructed. "I can't," she cried. "I can't walk. I can't breathe. Ahmeek, God." The sight in front of Messiah was devastating. He knew he had himself to blame, but the sight of Morgan leaning on his man for help, clinging to him in her time of need, saying his name so intimately, it tore away pieces of his soul. It was like someone was filleting pieces of him from the bone, slicing flesh clean off. It hurt so bad. In that moment, he wished that he had let the cancer take him, because witnessing this, damn, no man was supposed to see this shit. He knew he'd left instructions for Meek to love Mo through her loss, but none of that mattered right now. He saw red. "Yo, bruh," Messiah started, lifting his hands and clapping them together one time in warning before bringing praying hands against his mouth. He shook those hands, pointing them at Meek as he spoke his next words. "I swear to fucking God, I will end you, my nigga," Messiah threatened. Mouth sneered in unbelievable rage. He had never felt anything like the hatred that coursed through his veins in this moment. "Pause, nigga. You ain't got no right, Pimp-tastic. Your ass was supposed to be dead. Fuck out of here. You are the motherfucker that set this shit in motion because you told your nigga to go love on your bitch. That's what you said. Run it back. You said that shit. So why the fuck is you mad? Because you decided to have the surgery and the chemo and the radiation and all the other experimental treatments. They done sliced and diced your ass and pieced you back together like some sort of black ass Frankenstein. And now you think you're supposed to come back and wreck shop and fucking remove motherfuckers who now love each other? I think the fuck not. Go on over there to Blue. Make another motherfucking baby, cancer boy, because ain't nobody checking for you and your bullshit over here. And that's fucked up that I keep calling him cancer. Like, this nigga is annoying. Why the fuck won't he just go away? This nigga's like a fucking bee at a picnic, just buzzing. Get the fuck on, pimp. Ethic keep telling you to leave this fucking girl alone, and you keep popping up like a nigga in the box. Just keep popping up. Go away. Oh my God. I'm sick of him popping up and shit. Go some damn where. All right. Let me calm the fuck down, because I am fucking upset, this nigga, man. Meek released Morgan and came off his hip, pistol in hand, because he already knew how Messiah would carry it. M and M and M. At a standoff, Messiah drew on Meek, gripping a .45 in one hand. Meek knew Messiah was seconds off the trigger because Messiah's free hand gave him away. Those fingers were rubbing. Messiah was itching to lay somebody down. They stood there, squared off, both gripping pistols in their palms, trigger fingers in position, but guns resting at their sides. Messiah shook his head. "I'ma need Shorty back," he said. "You know me. I don't keep what don't want to be kept," Meek said. Morgan trembled under the safety of one of his arms, squeezing her eyes so tight they hurt. This was a bad dream, the worst nightmare she'd ever had. Her heart thundered, and she just couldn't catch her breath. She loved Messiah, but she was terrified of him, so confused about who he was. Had she ever really known him? Mizan's brother. He had told her she didn't matter. She screamed that she was easy to forget. Oh no, he screamed that she was easy to forget, and now he was here. Where the fuck had he been the past 2 years if not in a grave? dying was better. Dying meant he was forced away from her. Choosing to stay away, leaving her, deserting her was unforgivable. Morgan's legs lost all strength. If Meek pulled away from her, Morgan would fall to the floor. She would crumble. So she clung there because between the two of them, she trusted Meek more. She had loved Messiah first, however. She had loved Messiah blindly, and she could still feel the pull of his energy drawing her to him. Her body begged her to go to him, but she couldn't oblige. Her mind screamed for her to stay away. She loved them both, but trust was non-existent between her and Messiah. Meek didn't lie. Meek didn't deceive. Messiah had destroyed her, was destroying her in this moment. She couldn't even face him. Pause. All Morgan gotta say is, yo, Messiah, I don't want you here. I don't want you. It's over. You left me. I'm done. You're dead to me. Like, literally, my nigga. You are fucking dead. You should have stayed the fuck away. They had told me that you was dead, nigga. Stay dead. Go back to being dead. Look, I'm waving my hand in front of my face like John Cena. I can't see you, nigga. So you can't see me. Get the fuck on. Press on, Flintstone. Don't nobody want your ass here. Bye. But she ain't saying shit. So that's making him think that, oh, I got something to fight for because she might still want a nigga. No, bruh. No. 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 You don't get to do that. You don't get to do that. Sorry, not sorry. Ugh. Messiah's lip trembled and his face broke into lines of agony. Shorty. Meek, please make him leave. Meek stepped to Messiah, reaching out to touch him, and Messiah snapped his hand down so hard that his own skin felt the sting of the connection. Nigga, you touch me, I'ma put them simple-ass thoughts in your head on the floor, pussy. Messiah was livid. He knew how this had happened. He had thought he would be okay with it. The idea was more noble than the reality. His friend and his girl, they were his. They both were his people, and they had coped with his disappearance by leaning on one another. Witnessing it was fucking eating Messiah alive. Messiah rushed Meek, throwing a blow so vicious that Messiah felt the bones in his hand break on impact. Meek tossed Messiah, returning with aggression, matching Messiah's energy. They tore up the entire hallway of her apartment building as they attacked one another. Blow for blow, neither one backing down. Friends turned adversaries over their affection. For the same woman. No, God, stop, Morgan shouted. She pulled Messiah's arm and he turned around so fast that he didn't think first. He was in a blind rage and he didn't snap out of it until he felt his hand across her face. Slap! Aw, shit. The blow was so powerful it sent Morgan to the ground. Meek hemmed Messiah up, one hand to Messiah's collar and a forearm to Messiah's neck. No air. Messiah couldn't breathe and he didn't want to after the realization of what he had done hit him. The fuck is you doing, nigga? Meek barked, spitting and jerking Messiah hard against the wall as he spoke. He was livid. Meek wanted to pop Messiah, pull the trigger, and make the nigga disappear. He had been anyone else, he would already be slumped. If Meek had been anyone else, the same would apply, but they were brothers. Even with two hearts full of disdain and confusion, it was hard for either one of them to come to anything other than blows. Fists, you could recover from. Once bullets flew, there was no coming back from that. Morgan was a good girl with a thing for bad boys. She was addicted to the butterflies she had. Oh, she was addicted to the butterflies, and she had two plugs, two drugs, fucking addicted to the thrill. Eminem, Meek and Messiah, two killers, both deadly, equally cunning, at an impasse because not only did they both love the girl on the floor, they loved one another. Morgan was on all fours, weeping as she held her face with one hand, trying to stop the ringing in her ears. She opened her mouth, flexing her jaw to see if it still worked. It felt shattered. A bomb had gone off inside her head, and the sight in front of her was blindingly white. She could barely see. She groaned as she reached out for the wall. Meek grit his teeth and jerked Messiah hard against the wall in frustration before releasing him to go to Morgan's side. Even killing Messiah came second to Morgan Atkins. She was hurt. She was his priority, and Meek went to her side without hesitating because he was able to do what Messiah could not, put his emotions to the side for the woman he loved. Messiah stared down at them in agony. His lip trembled, and he turned to the wall. Fuck, he shouted as he punched it again. And again, again, and again, again, and again, he balled those bloodied knuckles and brought them to the side of his head then placed them to the wall, resting his head on top of them. His lips flattened and his nostrils flared as he pulled in air, trying his hardest to calm himself. You're gonna lose her, nigga. Straighten the fuck up, he thought. Morgan, he took one step toward her. Stay away from me, she cried, putting up one hand to keep him at bay as terror played a motion picture in her widened eyes. His handprint was on the entire right side of her face. Ahmeek picked her up from the floor, carrying her in his arms as she bawled on his shoulder while holding her injured face. Mo, I'm sorry, Messiah whispered, putting his hands on top of his head in distress. He hadn't meant to hit her, would never, could never. His temper, his aggression, it had gotten the best of him. He had just reacted. He wanted to hurt Ahmeek, never her, never, ever her. She had just been in the way. She had just caught him by surprise. He wanted to touch her, to pull her into his arms and cry, to tell her why he was so fucked up, why his love felt like pain. He wanted to beg her to dismiss Ahmeek because although Ahmeek was the better man, he would never, could never love her more. No one could. Messiah would pour out every ounce of blood that kept him breathing for Morgan. He would die for her, had damn near died just for the slightest chance to come back to her. He wanted to plead. The image before him enraged him, and he wished he could punish them for this love they had built. The love that was palpable at first sight, but he knew he had no right. He had told Meek to do exactly this, to love Mo back to life, to help her, to show her love still existed after him. But this wasn't after him. He wasn't gone. He was standing right here, and the jealousy he felt from seeing his friend and the love of his life together had made him black out. He had flipped the fucking switch so fast that he hadn't even realized he was seeing red. His temper was uncontrollable because even now, after hurting her, he still wanted to inflict pain, still wanted to curl triggers like it was a fetish. Perhaps it was because the thought of laying Meek down made his dick hard. Messiah wanted to murder somebody. He remembered nights like this when he felt like sending niggas to their maker. And he would race to Morgan, rushing through her door just to expel the energy. Pull up on her just to fuck her good, to murder something. Sex with her had been like therapy, but now he was picturing her with Meek. Her face was on the floor and fear lived in her eyes, eyes she wouldn't even bless him with looking into. Messiah couldn't breathe. He was fucking choking. Their bond, Messiah scoffed. The audacity of Morgan and Meek to have a fucking bond. It was wrapped around his neck and squeezing tight. Good, die, motherfucker, die. Their love was killing him. Bro, man, Meek stated, another day, G, I'm a man. I stand 10 toes behind everything I do. I'll pull up on you. Let me get her settled first. Let you get her settled, Messiah scoffed in disregard, in disbelief. Let you get my? Messiah pinched the bridge of his nose as he gritted his teeth. I ain't dead, Mo. I'm right here, shorty. Right here, baby. I ain't dead, but this shit, you with him, that's gonna kill me. It's gonna kill me, shorty. His voice cracked, and he cleared his throat, swallowing down the lump, stopping him from breathing. She wrapped her arms around Meek's neck, body convulsing. She was sobbing so hard, she couldn't even look at him. Messiah turned, taking burdened steps away from them, lowering his head as tears fell from his eyes. He quickly sniffed them away and burst through the door that led to the stairwell, because if he stood in front of the elevator to wait for it to open, they would witness his undoing. Nobody, not even Mo, could see the ways that she was breaking him. Messiah needed privacy to feel the destruction that he had caused. And it's a break in the chapter. I just need to pause because my fucking head is hurting. Well, it's Fuck Nigga Friday, and Messiah is Fuck Boy Emeritus. He's Fuck Nigga Emeritus, and he just popped up like a nigga in the box once again, just popping the fuck up. You wind the handle, crank it up, and this nigga pop out. Meek carried Morgan inside and sat her down on the kitchen island before moving to the freezer. He pulled out a frozen bag of vegetables and put it against her face. She winced in pain. Look, Mo, he whispered as he caressed the uninjured side of her face, moving her messy hair from her eyes as his dark stare burned into her. If you want me to back off, I'll do that. I want to be clear where it's laying with you. I love you. I do. I'll put it all on the line for you. But I know out of all of us, all, your position is the hardest. And I know you just want, no, and I just want you happy, Mo. I'm sorry, I'm reading up a line. I want to make you happy. But if Messiah changes shit, Morgan panicked as tears came to her eyes. She saw his lips, and she knew what he was saying, but she was reading the words, not hearing them. She couldn't hear him. She rolled terrified eyes up to him. "I can't hear," she said. Her chest heaved. "Meek, I can't hear you. I can't hear. Something's wrong." And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, this nigga done smacked the sound out of her. What in the entire fuck? And that is not funny. You ain't supposed to be getting those cochlear ear implants like jerk the fuck around and shit. Like, they be telling people, like, don't even go on roller coasters because, you know, your fucking head be bouncing back and forth. You know, when you're on the roller coaster, too much fucking shaking. That fucking shit, you'll pop them fucking things and then you'll be back in the land of the unhearing. And that's just, man, this nigga, man, I promise you, I am fucking annoyed. Fucking, not I'm fucking weak, not a nigga in a box. That's exactly what he is. Stupid motherfucker, just like, man, I don't even understand. I don't even get it. Like, I'm sorry. I want her to heal because she's not good enough for herself, let alone another person. This is true. This is true. But like, Messiah needs to get the fuck out of here. Like, I don't get it. I'm sick of him. Like, I'm tired of his punk ass, right? You already fucked her up when you fucking dipped on her and shit. And you a snake ass nigga, you fucking anaconda you. Because you was fucking gonna kill fucking Ethic. And then what? She was supposed to be with you after that, my nigga? Like, you the one gonna pop her daddy and then fucking, like, all this fucking, man, you a piece of shit, bro. Fuck you. And I understand that she loved you because she didn't know all that, but you a clown ass nigga for that, man. You a old sauerkraut ass nigga. You a worthless ass, nothing ass, useless ass, motherfucking trash bag ass nigga. Go away. Go away. My grandma said, the worst thing you can call somebody is lousy. That word is so fucking, it's a horrible word. And Messiah is a lousy ass nigga. He's lousy, just fucking useless, pointless, scum of the earth, motherfucking snail sludge, nigga. You are fucking scumbug. That's who the fuck you are. Do y'all know who scumbug is? Scumbug was, anyway, just, he is fucking scumbug. I don't get it. I just say he a scum. His name is scumbug and he's a scumbag. Like, what the fuck, man? I just can't. He's a treacherous ass nigga. And she need to fucking not even out. You know, nope, because he seemed like the type that has fucking snatched the kids and be like, they man, shorty, they man. Fuck out of here. No, nigga, no. These is not your kids. Fuck out of here. Mm-mm. No, I feel some type of way. I just feel like he should just go away and leave her be. Just leave her be. Chapter 19. There's damage to the inner ear. We'll need to remove the implant, then reinstall a new cochlear device to see if the nerves are viable for auditory reconnection, the doctor said. Morgan read his lips and dread filled her. So two surgeries, she signed. Yes, two surgeries. One to remove the implant and another to reinstall. Morgan's lip quivered as two large tears spilled down her cheeks. Do you want to tell me how this happened? The doctor asked. If you're unsafe. Morgan shook her head as her chest rocked. I fell, she signed. I'm fine. The gentleman in the hallway. Is he hurting you? Your face is bruised, the doctor pushed. No, he wouldn't. He didn't do this, Morgan signed. The doctor sighed because they both knew that she was withholding something. I'll prepare for surgery in the morning. The nurses will get you settled in. The doctor opened the door and Meek sat on the floor, leaning against the wall with her twins in front of him. Yara had his car keys and Masari had his cell phone. Morgan gave him a sad smile that melted into tears. He climbed off the floor, wrangling her children into the room. You sit here, homie, he said, putting Masari in the comfortable chair. And you sit here. He placed Yara right beside him. He handed them his possessions again and Yara lifted the phone to her mouth. He pulled it from her hands and held the phone near his face to get her attention. No, no. Morgan stood and took the phone from him. She gave it to Yara and signed, no, no, don't eat it. He was cute. He tried, but he didn't know sign language. He couldn't converse with Yara. Mo didn't like when people tried to make up their own language to communicate with her child, like she was a pet they were teaching or something. People had done that to her entire life. She hated it. She knew Meek meant well, so she held her tongue and gave Yara the phone. She turned to Meek, who placed hands on the side of her face. I can't hear, Meek. There's damage. I need surgery, she said. Insecurities filled her because she couldn't hear herself. Her insecurity over the sound of her voice, the projection, the volume, it sprouted instantly. It made her not want to speak at all. She was back to being the poor deaf girl. She could see the pity in Meek's glance. He wouldn't want her like this. No one would want her like this. She was back to being damaged goods. How could he? She asked. Meek wrapped strong arms around her, and she withered in his embrace. He pulled back, pinching her chin, between two fingers, and kissed her lips. You're going to be fine. I'm going to pull up on Messiah, iron shit out. Let him know how it's laying. Let him know you waited, that we waited before this happened. Everything will be okay, Meek said. Morgan couldn't focus on his eyes to see if he meant the words. She had to focus on his lips. It would be the only way for her to understand what he was saying because Meek couldn't sign. She already felt disconnected from him, and it had only been a few hours. She closed her eyes and rested her head on his chest. She wasn't facing the door, so she didn't know it had opened until she felt Meek tap her shoulder. She turned and her brow lifted in surprise as Bash stared at the two of them, then rolled eyes over to the twins, then back to her. Confusion filled the room. Mo's lip quivered. She opened her mouth to explain until she felt Meek's hand gripping her chin, manipulating her gaze until it landed on him. You don't owe nobody no explanations, Mo. None. Not one, he said. You want me to stay or go? Morgan turned her head to Bash. Meek turned it back. Look at me. What do you want? Her eyes missed it. She couldn't even tell him how she felt. All of a sudden, she had a fear of speaking. It was like it had come back, the muteness that came with her deafness, like they were a package deal. She felt Bash's eyes on them. She stared at Meek, his handsome face blurred behind the emotion in her vision. She wanted him, but then there was Messiah. He was back and somewhere down inside her, beneath the anger, behind the betrayal, in the depths of her soul, underneath the abandonment, even after this slap, she still loved him. She didn't want to hurt him, even though he had hurt her, even though she was in this hospital because of him, even though she had spent the past 2 years questioning everything he had ever told her. She still loved him. She didn't want him, could never have him because things would never be the same, but she didn't want to hurt him. She didn't want to hurt either of them. Messiah, the boy who had broken her, and Ahmeek, the boy who was fixing her, who had the glue that could mend her heart. Then there was Bash. Morgan looked over at him. He stood flabbergasted and red in the face. Bash was boring. Hey, man, it's time for you to leave, Bash said. He made the mistake of touching Ameek's shoulder, and without a thought, Meek introduced his burner to Bash's middle, pulling him close so that the twins didn't see what he held in his hands. Yo, you put your hands on me again, and I'll lay you flat, boy, Meek stated. Meek saw red and his heart raced because he knew Morgan was about to dismiss him. He wasn't even angry at Bash. He was angry at life, at Messiah, at himself forever falling for Morgan in the first place. Now he might lose her. He suddenly understood the rage Messiah had expressed years ago on Blue's front lawn when he was put in the very same position. Losing a woman like Mo just made a man murderous. It made him bleed emotion. He felt her indecision, and he knew why. Messiah was back, and what once seemed like a possibility had become an impossibility in an instant. Morgan, call off your dog, Bash said, trying not to show his fear. Pause. You see, that's the fucking problem right there. Bitch nigga Bash. That's his new name. Bitch nigga Bash. Okay? B&B. Bitch nigga Bash. Always popping strong. Nigga, you a bitch. Your mama run your whole motherfucking life, has, since the moment of your raggedy ass conception. Shut the entire motherfucking fuck up, bitch nigga. Don't nobody give a fuck about what you saying. You not hard, nigga. You moist. You soft like fucking hot butter. You are soft as fuck. You don't run shit. Not even your own life. Your mama tell you when you should be up, what you should be doing first, when to take a shit. When to pee, when to shower, nigga. Your mama runs your life. You are a bitch, nigga. Bash, shut it up. Damn. She pulled his arm, but Meek didn't give. He stood there, eyes burning into Bash's. Intimidation shrinking Bash because he was so fucking angry. It wasn't even about Bash. It was about Morgan Atkins. It was about Messiah. It was about the tug of war that he was in with his best friend's girl, a battle he should have never indulged in. But now that he had, He couldn't let go, no matter how much the rope burned as he held tight. Morgan put herself between Meek and Bash, pushing Meek back. He tucked his gun in his waist, pulling his jacket down over the handle, but his eyes never left Bash. Morgan pulled his face down, using his beard as her leash to get him to look into her eyes. "Stop," she mouthed. He nodded and sniffed, then ran a hand down his face as she moved her hands up the sides of his face, wrapping them behind his ears and then pulling his forehead to hers. "Stop." She opened her mouth and spoke the words, using every single ounce of courage she had to speak without being able to hear. She didn't know how she sounded. She hoped she had whispered it, hoped that it sounded the same as before and didn't highlight her disability. A tear fell down her cheek as he kissed her lips, her eyes closed, his eyes open, hawking Bash, daring Bash to do something about it. The emotions filling the moment were too high to continue to be discreet. He wanted to kiss her. So he did. Yes! Kiss your woman, nigga! She knew it might be the last time, so she let him. "This is bullshit," Bash muttered before storming out the room. "Yep, that nigga name written all over that cutie cat, and you ain't even had none. You and your mammy have set her life up, have indulged her in all of London's upper crust society for the past 2 years. You ain't even tapped that thing, man. Do you know what it smell like? Because Meek do." "Bitch, nigga Bash. B&B. Morgan, pull back. You should leave, too. Meek took in the vision of her, the fucking unbelievable beauty that was Morgan Atkins, and he nodded, kissing her forehead before grabbing his belongings from the twins. He finessed the tops of their heads gently, then looked back at her one time before walking out. Morgan blew out of breath, overwhelmed, and gripped her stomach before turning to her babies. "It's just us," she signed to them. "They all want to be everything to me. I just don't know which one belongs here. Maybe none of them. Maybe it's supposed to be just the three of us." Morgan fisted her hair and spun away from them in distress, doubling over as anguish destroyed her face. She gritted her teeth and struggled to fix her face as she stood straight. Her thumb chased away her tears, and she sniffed uncontrollably as she tried to stop the flood. Three men loved her. Why couldn't she find it in her to love herself? She knew why. She knew that one of them, Messiah, had made her feel so worthless that she didn't see a point. She didn't feel valuable, worthy. He had destroyed her. Morgan cleared her throat and pursed her lips before blowing out one last breath. She turned to her babies, her beautiful, sweet angels. They looked at her with unassuming eyes, shining so bright and innocent that Morgan's lip trembled. She got on her knees in front of her babies, in front of Messiah's babies, and kissed the tops of their heads. "We'll be okay. I promise," she signed. "I promise you." And it's a break in the chapter. Oh, my God. I can't. I'm just like, what the motherfucking fuck? Not he didn't hit her slow bopper for Christ ass hard enough to bring some damn sense in that heifer. Wait, Nordic, we are not condoning domestic violence, ma'am. No. No, 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 no. Oh my God, right, never underestimate your end. Yeah, you know I know that. Listen, if don't nobody else know it, I know it, okay? No, baby, you get that ingrained in you. Y'all listen, that's some shit that Chicago puts in your fucking DNA, you heard me? At the moment of conception, no matter where you conceived, if you're gonna end up growing up in Chicago, Chicago reach out and tickety-plow, put that right in your DNA. Right. Like, yeah, I feel you coming. You on your way to Chicago, so I'm gonna put that in you so you be ready. All right, they don't call it the city of big shoulders for nothing, my nigga. All right. Ethics stood on the ladder, pulling the heavy plywood up each step. He put the wood to the broken window of his shop and then pulled the nail gun from his tool belt. Ooh, I would love to see Ethics sweating while he worked. Ooh, anyway. He fired four studs through the sturdy wood. He heard the screeching tires of an approaching car and reached for the other gun on his hip. He relaxed when he saw Messiah and he came down off the ladder. Messiah didn't even shut his car door as he hopped out, frantic, worked up, angry. "She's fucking that nigga," Messiah said. "She's fucking him. I saw red. I didn't mean to, man." Messiah's lip trembled as he held up his hands in front of his face. They were swollen and bloodied. "I didn't fucking mean to, man. She's fucking my best friend and I lost it. What's wrong with me?" ethics temple throbbed because he heard the makings of remorse breaking through Messiah's distress. It could only mean one thing. He could see the regret hanging from Messiah, but it didn't matter. If Messiah had done what ethics suspected, it was already too late to make amends. Grab that board for me and hold it up, ethics stated, using every inch of discipline he had to remain calm. Your problem, Messiah, is that you don't think before you act. You let another man control your emotions and your reactions. You don't take pause, he said, as Messiah lifted the board. That's how you lose your temper, when you don't think, when you don't take a minute to weigh the consequences to your actions. I hit her. I fucking hit her. She's everything to me, man, and I... Ethic grabbed the back of Messiah's neck and slammed it against the wood. Pew! He pulled the trigger. Ah! A 9-inch nail went through the center of Messiah's hand. Fuck! That's the hand you hit her with? Ethic asked as he leaned onto Messiah's injured hand, adding pressure to the nail that impaled it. Messiah grit his teeth, screaming through a clenched jaw. He writhed in pain as Ethic leaned on his bleeding hand. I'm gonna say this to you one time, Messiah, Ethic said. The calm in his tone was terrifying because it didn't match the anger that Messiah knew was coursing through Ethic's veins. You ever touch her with anything other than love again, and I'll kill you. I taught you to be a man. Men have self-control. You fucking act like I taught you something when you're dealing with anyone who belonged to me first. Ethic eased up a bit, removing some of the pressure on Messiah's injured hand. I love you like you're my own. I think you know that. I'm glad you're home. I'm glad you're well, but I will never allow you or any other nigga to harm her and think there aren't repercussions. He pressed down on that hand again, and Messiah grimaced. That pain was so great, Messiah thought he might pass out. You won't intimidate. You won't raise your fucking voice. You get mad, you better whisper, my nigga, because she come to me and tell me you abused her in any way, mentally, physically, emotionally. I'm coming to kill over mine. Ethic tapped Messiah's chest. I'll touch you right there. Lay you down flat with no fucking remorse if you ever touch her again. Do you understand? I wanted to be clear because this isn't a conversation to be had twice. It's clear, Messiah said, gasping and cringing in excruciation. I don't understand why Ethic keep on giving this motherfucker a chance, bruh. Flatten this nigga wig right there. I ain't bullshitting. Put a motherfucking old-ass motherfucking pomade-ass press to this nigga's wig. Straighten that shit. Fuck it. Straighten the waves, my G. Like, I'm sick of this nigga. Ethic reached for the hammer in his tool belt and used the end of it to grip the nail in Messiah's hand. Wait, man, damn, you couldn't hit a nigga? You had to put a fucking nail through me, OG? Messiah asked, gritting his teeth and breathing heavy as he prepared himself for what was about to come. You lucky I ain't put a nail in your coffin, G, Ethic answered. He pulled out the nail swiftly. Fuck, Messiah shouted. Ethic walked inside and grabbed a towel, then wrapped Messiah's hand. I need help, man. I don't want to be bad for her. I want to love her. I do love her. I just want my girl back. The vulnerability leaking from Messiah made Ethic exhale. A long, deep breath left his body because he knew that Messiah loved Morgan as best as he knew how. He wasn't fluent in any other emotion besides rage, and Ethic knew that Morgan was the test dummy for Messiah's affections. It was a dangerous place to be. I need you to show me how to love her. Teach me, man. Teach me how to love her the way you love Alani. I'm fucked up. I don't know how to do that. I just want to love her. Messiah sat on the ledge of the boarded up window, nursing his bloody hand, elbows resting on his knees as his head dropped in despair. I just gave her up. I told him to take care of her, told him to love her, and now he with her. But I just want to be with her, and I want to murder that nigga. Knock off that corny nigga, too. I just want to kill everything standing between me and her. Listen to me, Ethic said as he sat down beside Messiah. Morgan has had niggas like Bash sniffing behind her since she was 12 years old. She's settling with him. I wasn't aware of Ahmeek. I thought they were friends, but if they're more than friends, it's because he's giving her what she's missing without you. She's searching for you in him. He's familiar. Your worry shouldn't be another nigga being with Mo. It should be making sure you're worthy of Mo. She has some shit to tell you. Same way you've got some shit to tell her. Y'all need to talk. You're connected to her in ways that another man will never be. She'll let you come home when you act like you deserve to. Get your shit together, Messiah. Leave the streets alone. Get your temper in check. It's not just her. You'll have two kids involved. They need a home. They need somewhere safe. They need stability. Be better for her. I've seen her with the nigga Ahmeek. I've also seen him with her. She's searching for the best part of you in every nigga she meets. I told you that before, that if you moved incorrectly, if you went away, got locked up, died, the woman you love would spend her life trying to identify you in other men. You went away and you came back, and not one but two men have ties to your girl. You gave them opportunity. The nigga Bash ain't no problem. You could sweep him up out the way with ease, but Ahmeek? The nigga you ran with, the nigga you got money with, she smiles with him, Messiah. If you ever want to get her back, you got to learn how to ease her pain, not cause it. You got a man to fuck up. There's a competition for her heart, and right now you're losing. What you willing to do to get your girl back? What you willing to endure to fix what you broke? Because it's hard work, it's painful, and if you ain't going to see it through to the end, don't even get her hopes up. Don't even start if you're not going to finish it. But if you love her, you fight for her and you tear yourself apart to build her back up. It was easy making her love you the first time because you all she knew. Now she knows better. Now she's had others. Only the best man will win. Messiah bit back his emotion as Ethic put a firm hand to his shoulder. Let's go see about that hand, Ethic stated. The best man will win indeed. Better make sure it's you. And that's the end of that chapter. Man, listen, Ethic, shut your ass up, bruh. Stop fucking gassing this nigga up. Damn. You gassing him up like a brand new car. Stop that shit. Don't gas him up. Fuck him. Tell him, you know what, homeboy? You done lost, my nigga. You have lost. It's over with. Wave the white flag. Bow the fuck out. Find you another bitch. You lost, nigga. The race is over. It's over. Mm-mm. Oh, man. I don't know. Like, I guess Ethic is trying to say, you know, people make mistakes when they're blinded by emotion. I don't give a fuck. No. No. And I mean, I get it. Messiah didn't mean to hit Morgan, but I don't give a fuck. He done already tore all the stuffing out of her motherfucking ass when he motherfucking left. He tore the stuffing out, then ripped the lining out on Blue's front porch in front of everybody. The whole crew was there to bear witness. Like, what the fuck? This nigga don't deserve another chance. Fuck out of here, nigga. No, you don't deserve another chance to fuck up again. I know you lying. Mm-mm. No. Sorry, go on somewhere. All right. I don't give in to the, oh, I made a mistake. No, talk, nigga. You got a fucking mouth. Use your fucking soup coolers for more than fucking blowing off ramen noodles. Fucking asshole. Mm-mm. I don't like that shit. Like, don't be that nigga, man. Don't be that one. Be better. Do better. Fuck ass, Chauncey. All right. Chapter 20. Morgan hadn't realized how much she missed this type of silence. The deafening silence, the ominous silence, the kind that nothing penetrated. Not the drip of a leaky sink, not the call of a bird outside of a window, not even the hum of the machines around her. She heard nothing. She felt the tears, though, felt her heart beating, felt her mind spinning, her gut tensing. She couldn't believe he had smacked her. The side of her face was swollen, lip busted, and the makings of a bruise was forming near her ear. Alani sat near the bedside, holding Masari as Yara colored on the floor. Alani had come prepared with a bag full of distractions for the twins, and Morgan was grateful for her help. She felt the squeeze of her hand, and Morgan didn't turn her head to look, but she gave a squeeze back. Her life felt like it was in shambles. The man she wanted, she couldn't have. The man she hated, she kind of also loved. And the one she was indifferent about, she had hurt. Nobody deserved to be hurt. She was dead wrong, and she told herself that when she was out of the hospital, she owed Bash an apology. If she had made him feel even a fraction of what Messiah made her feel, she wasn't shit. Still, even with Messiah putting hands on her, she felt him in her soul. She had wondered why she had always lived with him. He lingered in the deepest chambers of her heart. There was just an energy she felt, a whisper to her soul, like he was somewhere out there calling out to her, Shorty. Now she knew why. Alani lifted Mo's hand in the palm of one hand. Their eyes met, and then Alani swept her hand across the injured side of Morgan's face. "Ethics on his way up," Alani said. Morgan read her lips and nodded. "I'm going to head out with the twins. Get them to bed. We'll be back in the morning, okay?" Morgan nodded and then swung her feet over the edge of the bed to stand. She picked up Masari and kissed his cheek and then bent to scoop Yara. She hugged her daughter tight and then handed her off to Alani. They made their way out, and Morgan sat there feeling shut off from the world. It wasn't as bad as she remembered. When she was younger, being deaf had felt like a flaw. Right now, with chaos in the hearing world, she felt lucky to be able to turn it all off. Ethic pushed open the door. Morgan's lip trembled. He always made everything better. He was comfort, but when she saw Messiah step in after him, it felt like a bomb had detonated inside her. "Why is he here?" she shouted. She didn't even care that she didn't know how she sounded. She had to scream, needed to yell. "Shorty, can I just talk to you for a minute? I'm sorry, Mo," he pleaded. Morgan's entire body trembled, and she broke down, tears running down her pretty cheeks as he approached her. "Your face, your ears, I'm so sorry." Morgan was on top of Messiah before he could even finish his sentence. She swung. "How could you?" she shouted. She didn't even care how she sounded. She screamed those words from the pit of her soul. "I hate you!" Her fists flew so viciously, and Messiah folded into her, wrapping his arms around her waist, burying his face into her breast as she beat him. "How fucking dare you? Fuck you! You left me here to die!" She connected with the back of his head, and Messiah allowed her to get her blows off. He could feel her soul cry, and in his twisted heart, he absorbed those punches as love taps. He cherished every painful blow because for so long he hadn't felt her at all. Even absorbing her hate felt like love. This wasn't about the slap. This was for it all. This was an outpouring of all the hurt he had left her with. "I needed you, Morgan," Ethic shouted, moving to intercept her. "No, OG, let her get this off," Messiah said as Ethic stood between them, bear-hugging Morgan. Morgan lunged for Messiah, but Ethic's hold was too strong. She grabbed the remote control off the bed and tossed it at him. "Get the fuck out!" Everything in her reach flew across the room. "Morgan," Ethic barked. "Do you know what you did?" she cried. She picked up the blood pressure monitor and tossed it. It crashed into pieces at Messiah's feet. The pillows, the box of gloves that sat on the stand by the bed, the IV, everything within reach became bullets that she wanted to send his way. Morgan wanted to kill him. Messiah dodged all the items, stepping back, then placing both hands on top of his head in despair. He didn't know how to stop this, how to control it. She was so damn mad. "Shorty, let me just get a word. I'm sorry, baby. I'm sorry. Let me get out," Morgan yelled. "That's all you're good for anyway." Ethic could barely contain Morgan. He had witnessed a lot of meltdowns by Morgan, but he had never seen her like this. Messiah was dejected, his heart fucking split. "Shorty, please, man." A nurse entered the room. "Sir, I'm going to ask you to leave." "I can't, man. She's mine. She belongs to me. Shorty, you belong to me, Mo, baby." Morgan's face was buried in Ethic's chest, and she was sobbing so badly that Messiah's eyes filled. "Sir, make us call security." "Bitch, I'll put a bullet through your skull. She here. This where I'ma be." Messiah refused to leave, and Morgan refused to look at him. He focused on Morgan in Ethic's arms. Why couldn't she run to him like that? Why couldn't she seek comfort in him just like fucking that? He wanted to kill Ethic just so he could take his place. He wanted to be her security. Instead, he was her turmoil. "Messiah," Ethic stated. Messiah swiped a hand down his face, clearing tears he didn't even know had fallen. She was gutting him. This reunion was going so much differently than what he had imagined in his mind. "Ethic, please, man, I just want her. She's my shorty." "Messiah." Ethic's voice held a tone that was forceful but empathetic. So much heartbreak in the room. Grief, angst, regret. Messiah had been gone for too long. Too much had changed, and that change was terrifying him. "Man, fuck him. Fuck his feelings, bitch ass nigga." Messiah knew there was no bargaining. Ethic didn't need to say more. He had already repeated the order twice. "A nigga love you with his whole heart. That motherfucker beat the fuck up, and it don't always work how it's supposed to. Shorty, but it's yours. I'm sorry, Mo." Security came into the room. "Sir, we have to escort you off the premises," the uniformed officer said. He made the mistake of touching Messiah, and he spazzed, slapping the officer's hand so violently that he reached for his gun. Ethic reached for his. "I promise you I'm a quicker draw. They gonna be asking if white lives matter if you don't get your hand off that gun," Ethic stated. The officer lifted four fingers off the gun but kept his hand ready. So did Ethic. Tension thickened the air in the room, and Messiah's eyes burned into Morgan's, pleading with her. He's leaving. He doesn't need to be escorted out. Won't be no handcuffs, no guns drawn. He's a man. He's going to walk out on his own, too, Ethic stated. Let me get right with you, Shorty, Messiah sighed. I want to come home. No, I don't want to be half-loved. I'm too full of life for that, Messiah. You don't commit. You say that you will, and then you pull out. You lie, and you deceive, and you disappear, she signed. I begged you. I love you, Mo. Fuck you. Fuck your love. Fuck what you did. I loved you all the way, and you left me. You spit on what we had, and you left me. Morgan was signing the words so hard that her entire body rocked as she cried. Listen, there she go. Motherfucking trumpet fingers. This bitch is saxophone fingers McGraw. Then you come back and you act like I owe you something. You want to raise hell and make a scene because I'm with Ahmeek. Like he owes you something. We don't owe you shit. You've been dead to us for 2 years. He's good to me, Messiah. Before it was anything else, before it turned into anything else, he was my friend. I owe you nothing. You destroyed me. She turned her head toward the window and Messiah lifted his gaze to Ethic. Please, man. It didn't even sound like his voice. His heart was in his stomach and he wanted to stay, but he couldn't. Not yet, because hearing her talk about Ahmeek like she loved him, defending him, praising him, it made a fire kindle inside his chest. He didn't want to love her wrong. He didn't want to hurt her more, and he feared what he would do if he stayed. Ethic was right. He had to get right for her. He had to grow up. He had to learn self-control. He had never possessed that, but if he wanted to ever gain her adoration again, he would have to learn it. I'll be better for her, man. I'll do whatever it takes. Messiah was breaking and Ethic's heart was torn down the middle. Messiah was like a son to him in a lot of ways. They shared this hurt. Just tell her to give me a chance to listen to me, OG. Ethic turned to Mo, taking her trembling chin in his hand and forcing her to look at him. I know it hurts, he signed, but this is a second chance, Mo. You gotta think about everybody, not just you. About your family, Morgan. Hear him out. Morgan pierced Messiah with her stare. Those pretty ass eyes, eyes he had stared into for hours, now marked him. He felt so privileged. I can't hear you, Messiah, she signed to him, chest heaving, tears flowing. You take everything. Took my heart. My life, Messiah. You hit me so hard I can't hear. You took my hearing, Messiah. You took my soul. I was lost without you, and I waited for you to come find me, to come help me. I needed so much help, and you never looked back. You didn't come back for me. Ain't no home here. Not anymore. Get the fuck out my room. Messiah took a step forward. Messiah. His name halted him. Ethic's voice boomed, holding enough weight to keep Messiah from pressing the issue further. Ethic shook his head. She needs some time. Ethic's bark was close to becoming a bite, and Messiah had to grit his teeth to stop his chin from quivering. They were his family, his people, Ethic and Morgan. They were putting him out. Walking out of the hospital took great effort. He wanted to be selfish. He wanted to force his way back into her life, but he couldn't. She was home, but she had changed the locks, and Messiah would have to figure out a new way to get inside her heart. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, y'all. I'm so fucking sick of Messiah. I want to fucking... Oh, this nigga. I cannot. Let me see. Hold on. Let me see, because I don't think it's this chapter. It's not that long. All right, I'm going to give y'all this one, and then I'm out. All right, let me get my time stamp. Hold on. All right, I guess I'll come back and give y'all a little more after I do this. Yeah, but she ain't gonna do that. She ain't gonna do that. She can't fucking do that. Morgan is confused, and what she needs is, you know, for Arya to just tell her, go be with me, because that's where you want to be. That's why she fucking up. Fucking weirdo. Chapter 21. Pull up. Boy, pull down on me and go down on me. Arya laid under Issa's arm, one thigh wrapped around his thin torso, as he placed the blunt to her lips. Anne Marie's voice whispered to them in the background, thumping through the speaker so low that they almost couldn't hear the music. He looked down at her as she inhaled. She closed her eyes and held the smoke for a beat before lifting her chin and filling the room with clouds. Morgan is so fucked up, Arya whispered. Shit, I'm fucked up, Issa said. Every motherfucking hair on the back of my neck stood up when I heard my nigga voice. What happens now? Arya asked. We mind our business, Ali, Issa said, and you suck a little dick for a nigga. Suck a little dick for an outfit. Y'all remember that song? Anyway, Arya climbed on top of him. You talk so much, she snickered as she moved to the top of the bed, hovering over his face. She placed hands on the headboard. Put something in your mouth so you can say less. He groaned. He lifted the blunt with one hand, passing it off to her, then planted both hands on her ass, lifting her a little. Arya hit the blunt, causing her head to spin as Issa captured her peach. Her back arched as she rode his face to the beat. His phone rang, and Issa lifted her with one hand, then pulled his phone out of his pocket with the other. You stop to answer that phone and see what's gonna happen, she threatened. Issa peered down at the screen. Yo, it's bro. Hold up, he said. He put Arya down and she huffed her displeasure, crossing her arms and tilting her head to the side. Casper the friendly ghost ass nigga, Issa answered. Arya popped him upside his head. Damn, Ali, he shouted, wincing as he turned to her, light eyes burning into her. A warning, his large hand wrapped around her neck. Want me to fuck you up? He said. Arya's brow raised in challenge. That's exactly what I want. Now get off the phone. Issa snickered and shook his head as he put Messiah on speakerphone. My bad, brah. What up? You got a lot of fucking explaining to do, G, Issa said. Yeah, I know, man. Meet me at the spot. Messiah's voice entered the bedroom. Yup, Issa replied and then hung up. He leaned over to Arya. I gotta go. Wait up for me. Arya rolled her eyes as Issa rolled up from the bed, still pinching the blunt in her fingers. Fuck you. I'm going to sleep. Issa reached for a fresh shirt and slid it over his head, then retrieved his gun from the nightstand, tucking it in behind him. Yo, that wedding shit, I want to get on top of that. Get that shit together. Messiah put his toy down for a little while, and now it ain't his no more. I want my name on my toy, Issa stated. So I'm an object? She asked, brow lifted in challenge. Here you go, putting words in my mouth, man, Issa said. He walked over to her as she stood on her knees in the bed. He gripped her chin, pursing her lips, then kissed her so hard it felt like her lips would bruise. Annoying little ass. He pushed her back onto the bed and then turned for the door. Start planning, nigga. White dress, stupid ass suits, all that. She heard the door slam as she shook her head. She knew marrying a man like Issa was unwise. The life he led was dangerous. It was reckless. Damn, he was electric. Every time he looked at her, Arya felt a challenge in his stare, like she couldn't blink because the nigga would win her over. Everything about them was a power struggle, and she loved it. Rock, paper, scissors over her heart. He always put law down when he saw her. Didn't matter if it had been days or a few hours. He reminded her who she belonged to. It felt amazing to be coveted so dearly. She looked at her wrists and fingered the marks on them, bruises from the ties. Yes, God, call those trophies. Her skin was so soft that evidence of his preferences had been left behind. Arya wondered if they would last, if she could handle him forever, if she could take the pain he got off on forever. She had given him her body. She had taken his mind in return, but she was nervous about combining their souls. Issa had the ability to shatter her. He already had once before. As she looked down at the ring on her finger, she took a deep breath. Navid hated Issa. If she went through with this wedding, she knew her brother would never support it. Issa was an acquired taste, and he wasn't the type of man to put on a show to gain favor. There would be no sucking up to earn acceptance, and Arya feared losing her brother. She didn't want to have to sacrifice her relationship with her brother for the sake of love. Arya was terrified to merge her world with Issa's, but it was inevitable. She only hoped that she wasn't making a huge mistake. And that's the end of that chapter. Let me tell y'all something. Fuck out of here. You marry who you want to marry. And if your brother truly love you, he support that shit long as the nigga ain't putting, you know, hands that harm on you. You know what I'm saying? Y'all into some kinky shit and I'm here for it. So he will hurt you. But hurt, bringing pain that you are into is one thing. Harming is something totally different. That's something totally different. Don't harm me, my nigga, because I'll end you. Like, for real. I know y'all be like this. I'm addicted to bullets. What can I say? All right. So listen, I'm going to get the fuck out of here. All right. And we'll come back and we'll finish up this book because what do we have left? Let me see here. Oh, stop moving. 6, 7 chapters left. Right. Okay. So we have 7 chapters left. So it's saying it's about 1 hour and 40 minutes left in the book. So y'all know with me talking shit, that rounds it out to about a good 2 hours and something. And then we'll be done with book two. And hopefully we'll have some fucking closure. But how the fuck could that be possible when there is a book three and a goddamn book four and a book five that ain't even hit the motherfucking shelves yet? You heard me? Like, she's in the process of editing that motherfucker right now as we speak. I'm assuming she's still editing. I don't know, child. Knowing her irritating ass, it's probably already on the show. I love you, Ashley, but you annoy the fuck out of me with these characters, child. Oh, I hope Morgan is less of a slow bopper for Christ in this next book, child. Because, goddamn. Wait, did I say hi to Marva? I see Marva here. Did I say hi to you, girl? Child, I hope I did. Hey, Marva, I'm sorry, child. I don't even know if I said hi to you. I'm so sorry. I've been fucking reading comments and, child, listen, I'm so sorry. I missed your shit. I'm sorry, child. Marva probably gone like, fuck you, Saki. You ain't say shit. My bad. She probably like, I'm out of here. Bitch didn't acknowledge me. Them pulled up motherfuckers and girl, I ain't see your shit. My bad. I'm sorry. Fuck the speakeasy. Oh my God. Oh well. My bad. Shit. Blame it on StreamYard. You know, if I told y'all, listen, anybody right now who can hear the sound of my voice, if your motherfucking ass is here and you see I don't acknowledge your comment, motherfucker, say something again. Okay? Because this shit be jumping. Oh, I did. I spoke to you, child. Listen, because I couldn't remember. I'm just telling y'all. Say something again. Be like, hey, yo, I'm just letting you know I'm here again because StreamYard be jumping, child. And I'm sorry. I be missing y'all shit. I would never knowingly ignore anybody. If you here and I don't fuck with you, I'll block the fuck out of you. I won't just ignore you. I'll just block you. And then, you know, then I can't see you. So, yeah. All right, y'all. So, listen. I'm going to get the fuck out of here. I appreciate y'all listening to me read out loud. We are coming back. I have already prepared the thumbnail. I'm just going to put it in the system. Listen, now I sound like a fucking goddamn Social Security department worker. I'm going to put it in the system and then so I'm going to put it into StreamYard and then y'all, it'll be out there. So 2 minutes after this live stream ends, y'all will be able to click the little notify me button. That's if y'all give enough fuck to come back, you heard me? Because I know it's Friday and y'all motherfuckers done got paid and y'all got bills to pay and shit to do. So if y'all can make it back, come on back. If you motherfucking can't, I understand. But just, you know, over the weekend, at least like the motherfucking video, okay? Do that for me. Since you niggas don't give enough a fuck about me to come back and shit. Got me all off it. Y'all treating me like my name Messiah off up in this bitch. All right, y'all. Listen, I love y'all. Be careful as y'all travel the highways and byways of the YouTube verse. Make sure you look both ways crossing the street because listen, Linda, it's a bunch of loose ass drivers out there, okay? They will mow your ass down. And I love y'all and I want y'all to make it back to the speakeasy in one piece, okay? Thank you so much, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator, darling. I truly, truly love and appreciate you. And listen, y'all like the video on your way out? Stick around. Okay, because I'm going to end the music real quick, just like, and then boom, it's over with, all right? And I'm going to just make the next thumbnail right away. So 2 minutes, and then you'll be able to click notify me, because I don't want to hear no shit about, I ain't getting no motherfucking notification. That's not my motherfucking problem, because you should have sat your ass on my channel just refreshing the page till you see that upcoming coming up, all right? I know who the fuck did what was supposed to have been done. By who show up in the next live stream. All right, I'm out. Y'all be easy. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all.